The process is pretty extensive, and I don't want to spend a lot of time going through. The next two slides have 18 different steps that have to be completed before self-incorporation can actually come to fruition. A steering committee would have to be formed. The area to be incorporated would have to be defined. The services to be provided would have to be identified. The cost to provide services would have to be defined. The availability of state distributed monies would need to be identified. So there's a big long list of here. Area residents would need to be contacted. We would need at least 50 signatures. That petition has to be filed with the county. There has to be approval of municipalities within 3 miles. So there's a big long list here of things that have to happen before we can become self-incorporated. Frankly, this task is so large that I'm not sure White River Citizens United has the resources to support this. We would, I think, need to grow our organization before this could become a reality. If the community would want a group like ours to take on this, you know, we really don't think we have the resources to tackle this. It's such a large task. And that's what I thought 6 to 12 months ago. I don't know if I'm having second thoughts on some of the work that some of our guys have done. Some of our retired people have really done a lot of work, and I've been very astonished at what the amount of time that they've put into this. So moving past the self-incorporation option, we get to annexation. The benefits of annexation are it's a little quicker and a little easier than the self-incorporation option. We may not end up maintaining the community identity as best as we would like through self-incorporation. We may end up giving up some of our control to the town of Bargersville or the city of Greenwood, or maybe both. So those are some choices that we're faced with. Annexation can be an adversarial process. Some of you who live down in the area that the town of Bargersville is proposing to be annexed, you understand about that adversity. Annexation can still be expensive to do, and we're not going to venture an estimate on what that is. We don't have any good information there. The annexation has to be done parcel by parcel. The parcels that are being annexed have to be contiguous, or they have to actually touch the municipality that is doing the annexation. And I think at least 1/8 of the property's boundary has to be contiguous. There are two forms of annexation. There's voluntary and involuntary annexation. Voluntary is when it's initiated by the landowners. Involuntary is when it's initiated by the municipality. And I don't want to spend a lot of time on this because we're kind of getting into the technical aspects of the annexation process. But again, the town doing the annexation must have the consent of the city within 3 miles of the boundaries, is the way we understand the law. There's a relatively new law that was promulgated in 2006, and this is Indiana Code 36.1.5. This is part of the Government Modernization Act. And that merging process allows unincorporated White River Township to merge with, as I understand it, either town of Bargersville, city of Greenwood. I think in theory we could also merge with the city of Indianapolis. Although that's not an option that we're really here to, we haven't explored that option, and we're not really here to talk about that option tonight. But the benefits of merging, it's more cost effective than self-incorporation. It does allow community involvement, and it does require the approval of both the legislative bodies and the general public. merging requires a vote, as I understand it, of the citizens. The concerns, it requires significant effort and community participation, and it also requires educational process of the general public. This flowchart here looks pretty complicated, and the first time I saw this, I thought, man, we can't talk about this. This is just too complicated. But if you really, if you look at it for a minute, it's simpler than what it really looks like. Up here at the top, we have either the Greenwood Town Council or the City of Greenwood Council. And then over here to the right, we have the White River Township Board. And those two entities, they identify some representatives within their community to create this reorganization community. They each have to appoint three or more. So we're looking at least three from the White River Township Board, and then at least three from the Town of Bartersville or the Greenwood City Council. So we have a minimum of six individuals who are on this reorganization committee. And then they can decide what areas they want to focus on. And these are just examples here. We have finance, governance, health, safety, and welfare, parks and recreation, planning and land use, transportation, and utilities. And these are potential subcommittees that could be created. And again, they're just examples. They don't have to be these categories. They could be other categories. But then the people that they're appointing in the reorganization committee would perhaps chair each one of these. And they would seek input and representatives from throughout the communities to serve on these subcommittees. And then they would assemble a reorganization plan. And that plan would constitute these different elements or elements similar to what we're showing up here. Then once that plan is formulated in draft form, it goes to the Town of Bartersville or the City Council of Greenwood, and it goes to that body so that that body can vet the draft plan. It also, at the same time, goes to the Township Board for approval, and the plan goes to the Township Board so that it can be vetted as well at that level. So then it comes down here to voter approval, and the voters ultimately decide on whether the merger takes place or not, but only if these bodies, the Town or City Council and the Township Board, approve it. Without their approval, it does not get to the voters for a vote. Now we're to the, I guess I could call this the million-dollar question, how does this impact my property taxes? Again, this was a really difficult issue for us to tackle, but I want to recognize three individuals who really worked hard on this. And I mentioned John Griffin, Forrest Malott, and Mark DeVoe. These guys are highly intelligent, skilled individuals, detail-oriented, and they really dug into this. They really dug into the different legal requirements. They did a lot of research with the County Assessor's Office. They met with Dr. Larry DeBoer at Purdue University. They've spent weeks on this stuff. And this has probably been their full-time job for the last 6 months. But John is a retired electrical engineer from General Motors. Forrest is formerly with Eli Lilly, and he was one of their strategic planning people. And Mark DeVoe is a tax accountant, also formerly with Eli Lilly. So we think we have some pretty savvy people on our team. I've enjoyed working with them. And really, they deserve the credit for why I'm up here presenting this information.